Thank you, sir. At the outset, I'd like to thank all AIOS, Dr. Santosh Honawar, and especially my colleague in Pondicherry, Dr. Kavita, for helping me with the slides. I'm going to talk to you about optic nerve head evaluation. It's going to be a very simple talk, and we'll cut to the chase straight away. Is it on? Is it running? Control. Yeah? Okay, fine. So, optic nerve head evaluation, the clinical appearance of the optic nerve provides the most reliable early evidence of glaucoma. So, it's something which we should really look for and look carefully. And you must always remember the 5 R's whenever you look at the optic nerve head. So, first is the scleral ring to identify the limits of the optic disc and its size and shape. So, this is very important. Then you identify the neuroretinal rim, the color of the neuroretinal rim, and also the size at various quadrants, and then examine the retinal nerve fiber layer defect, whether it's present or not, and then also examine the region of the peripapillary atrophy and look for retinal and optic disc hemorrhage. So sometimes you don't get it at the disc, so if you look at the undilated examination, you may miss certain flame-shaped hemorrhages away from the disc. So look at the scleral ring to assess the disc size. So scleral ring can be of various shapes and sizes, and they come in various dimensions, so you have to look carefully for that. And there's a wide variation in the optic disc, 0.8 to 6.0, but for all practical purposes you can remember that it's about 1.25 to 2.95, so it comes in the proper range, and it's smaller in whites, intermediate among Asians, and largest among blacks. Because we are all brown skin people, we are more towards the black population. And if you use the well-challenged direct ophthalmoscope, you have the 5 degree aperture of that, and you apply it to the optic disc, and if it fits it, that means it's the correct size. You're looking at a normal optic disc. And of course, refractive errors will cause wide variation. So hyperopes, it will be something smaller like this, and myopes, it will be something on your right hand side. And it's usually vertical oval, which is the normal. If you're looking at anything different, then always apply some more tests to find out whether it's a normal disc or something abnormal. So like I said, the small disc, large disc, abnormal disc or dysplastic disc, and normal disc size you should remember. So cup border and the scleral rim border can always be in a dysplastic disc. You won't be able to identify it. It's very difficult. So you have the cup sizes is supposed to be proportional to the optic disc size in normal eyes. So in a large disc, you have a large cup. In a smaller disc, you have a small cup. And you should always note the neuroretinal rim. Now, the contour of the neuroretinal rim will follow the contour of the scleral rim. So if the neuroretinal rim is thinned somewhere, that means you have to see the shape of the scleral ring and then shape of the neuroretinal rim and then find out where it is thinned out. So both of them have to correlate with each other. And you also look at the size, color, and shape of the neuroretinal rim. And it follows the isn't rule. Usually the neuroretinal rim is inferiorly, it is the thickest, and then nasally it is, the superior is the second thicker, and then nasally it is third, and then the thinnest part is the temporal region. So you have to find out whether it is the pallor is equal, because the central part, which is the cup, is actually very pale. So that's where the neuroretinal rim doesn't exist, the nerve fibers are not there. So that's why it's pale. Now if the pallor exceeds the neuroretinal rim, that means you're not dealing with glaucoma. So you have to have an identification of that. So you have a pale rim and then a smaller cup, that means it's a neurological entity, not a glaucomatous entity. Similarly, you have to look at the kinking of the vessels. If the cup is more than the pallor, that means, and also look at the vessel, kinking of the vessels, so you have to suspect glaucoma in such case. So features that indicate damage include notching of the rim, asymmetry of the rim within the absence of asymmetric disc size, and abnormally thin rim in one or two sectors. So these are all features of an abnormality in the shape of the rim. So in the neuroretinal rim, you can have certain features which will tell you whether it's glaucomatous or not, like focal atrophy, selective loss of neuroretinal rim in the inferior and superior temporal vector sectors, vertical or oblique cup enlargement, and violation of the isn't rule. For example, in this image, you find that the inferior part, which is supposed to be the thickest part, is actually the thinned out region. So this is violation of the isn't rule. And here you can find a little bit of polar notching here. It's not very clear inferiorly, but superiorly you can find out there's a notch superiorly. Other features can be that you can have a concentric enlargement of the optic cup, and also the loss of the rim begins temporally and progresses circumferentially, or you can have a, there's no shelf there, so it's known as temporal unfolding. Notching is, of course, you have to look for, like I mentioned, there's a focal defect of the neuroretinal in certain areas. And then you come to the third R, which is a retinal nerve fiber layer. So you have the retinal nerve fiber layer is actually the loss of the ganglion cells, which precedes the visual field loss. And it appears as radially oriented striations. You can see this very well in red-free photograph, which I'll show subsequently. And it always follows the arcuate pattern. So if it's not in the arcuate region, then it's not related to glaucoma as such. And you have the normal retinal nerve fibers are really typically brighter in superior and inferior bundles. And in red-free light and photography, you can find out very clearly. And these defects are seen within two disc diameters of the optic disc. The retinal nerve fiber layer defects in glaucoma have to come to the disc. So you have a correlation between the loss of the neuroretinium as well as the retinal nerve fiber layer defects. Are we losing the images there? So you have certain slit-like defects, and also the wider, you have the wedge defects. And you can see them as dark bands extending from the margins of the optic disc. And if you have generalized thinning with loss of brightness and density of denture, that means they are generalized defects. And you can find that the blood vessels are, when you examine with stereoscopically, you can find that the blood vessels are a little bit anterior than the retina. So you find that they are not actually embedded in the retina. So that's how you find out. So if you have a red-free photograph, it shows very nicely you have a retinal nerve fiber layer defect here. And then in red-free, it is much better shown. And you can always serially, if you examine for over, for example, this photograph is taken 4 years apart, and you find that the RNFL defect has increased over a period of 4 years. And then you can also have diffuse loss. Like I mentioned, you have a diffuse loss of striations. The vessels are a little bit separated and above the retina. So again, after that, you have the fourth R, which is the assessment of the region of peripapillary atrophy. You have the alpha zone, which is hypo and hyperpigmented areas, which is away from the optic disc, and the beta zone, which is closer to the optic disc, which is atrophy of the retinal pigment epithelium. And if you look carefully, you can even, in serially, you can find out that the beta zone, as it increases, the adjacent area of the neuroretinium also thins out. So this is more common in glaucomatous eyes. So this is how it's, you can identify, label it, mark it, and then subsequently examine serially the patient. So the importance of beta zone is very important, mainly because the width correlates with the neuroretinal healthiness in that particular area. So a larger beta zone, you have a thinner neuroretinal rim. And of course, beta zone can also be, as it enlarges, it is also suggestive of progressive glaucomatous damage. So for example, this photograph, you can see that the beta zone has enlarged and the neuroretinal rim in that area is thinned out. So disc hemorrhages are a feature of glaucoma. Can anybody mention the synonym of disc hemorrhage? What do you call them as? One person? Any other synonym? Very good. Any other? Splinter hemorrhage. Any other synonym? Vancouver hemorrhages. So you must remember that. Splinter hemorrhages, disc hemorrhages, Vancouver hemorrhages, trans hemorrhages. Okay, so they're more common in NTG. They resolve on its own. So it's because of that you have to catch them. It's very difficult to predict when they're going to occur. But when you have them, you must document it. And in that particular area, you have to make sure that you mark it, because that area is going to be likely to get damaged faster. And these are signs of local vascular damage. So you know glaucoma is actually a mechanical as well as vascular pathological entity. So some of the other vessel signs which you should look for is the barring of the circumlinear vessel. So you find that the, when you examine it, you have to examine high magnification. When you examine high magnification stereoscopically on a slit lamp with a 90D or a 78D lens, you find that the vessel is away from the disc and it's sort of like floating in the air, so to say. And then again, like we said, there is a temporal unfolding of the neuroretinatum. There is also a nasalization of the vessels. So you find that the vessel, although is starting from here, as the nasal neuroretinatum thins out, the vessel starts falling on them and then start moving towards the nasal. So in fact, if it was a normal healthy eye and if you had seen it maybe 5 years before or 10 years before, you find that this alone area would have been the cup. But since it has progressed, you find that the vessels have sort of moved nasally and the whole length is on the nasal surface. And then the bayoneting sign. So the bayoneting sign is the loss of continuity of the vessel, as you see monocularly. So bayoneting, you won't find it stereoscopically, but monocularly, if you see with a direct scope, you'll find that there's a discontinuity of the blood vessel as it exits the disc and then comes onto the retina. So you'll find there's a parallax sort of an error. So these are certain things which you can pick up as you examine these patients, very typical signs of glaucoma. So how do we quantify how much the glaucoma, I mean how much glaucomatous is the optic nerve head? Is there a way to quantify it? What do you use it? What is the most common used? No, quantification. Disc exam, we have not gone to the OCT yet. Yeah, before that, before disc damage likelihood scale came up. We use commonly in your clinic, you are using it. How do you tell your professor that this guy has got glaucoma and Cupdish ratio? Who defined Cupdish ratio? Who described it first? So, Armalis method, you must remember this, okay? So, Armalis is the person who defined the description as taking it as a ratio of the cup size to disc type, and most commonly used quantitative classification mainly. And even a lot of studies like the ocular hypertension treatment study, all the studies have still used CD ratio to define progression in glaucoma. So it's a percentage of overall disc diameter. So the vertical CD ratio is very important. And if there's asymmetry between the discs, so one has 0.4, the other has 0.6, that is again a sign of that this patient has a tendency to develop glaucoma. So asymmetric CD ratio between the eyes is a significant sign. So this is something which you should remember. So example 0.2 and 0.45, 0.5 is significant. So you use a CD ratio, you use a woke lens, and then if you want to find out the correct size of the disc, there are correction factors, you have to multiply it by certain numbers, and then you get the CD ratio. So all this you can do in your classes. So the main disadvantage is it doesn't take the disc size into the consideration. So assumes that the central cup, that it sort of elongates concentrically. So what do you do with something which has been placed inferiorly or a cup which has been placed superiorly? You don't have, and there's always a inter-observer variability. Your professor may, you know, say 0.2, and then if you say 0.4 and if you're correct, I mean, you know, it's a difficult, delicate situation, just joking. But just to say that inter-observer variability is quite variable. And because of this, it's very less reproducible. So what do you want to use to have reproducible CD ratio? So we are talking about measurements. Now you say 0.3, I say 0.4. So how do you measure it? That's where imaging comes in. Okay, you scan something, it's on your paper, you take a scale and you measure it, finished, okay? But you don't have to take a scale because the computer will do it for you, okay? And somebody mentioned DDLS. So this is another way of quantifying it. Okay, like I mentioned, the nerve diameter is usually 1.25 to 2.95. So DDLS is made for 1.25 to 2.25, and anything more than that, it may be very difficult to apply this. So you get a, so CD ratio was about the cup to disc ratio. Now DDLS is what? Neuroretinal rim to disc ratio, because everybody says that NRR is more important. But if you want to describe to somebody what condition you are treating, it's very, very difficult to use a DDLS to say. So it has all these parameters in which you have to look for. And then if you have a stage of 1, 2, 3, 4, it is an at-risk disc. If you have 5, 6, 7, it's a glaucomatous confirmed damage. And 8, 9, 10, the patient is really suffering from advanced glaucoma disease. So there's a learning curve to that. you take, have to take some time and you have to see n number of discs to apply this test. It's not difficult, but in clinical practice, in a high volume center or if you have busy practice, it's very difficult to measure each time. And for atypical discs, dysplastic discs, like I said, there's no room for that. And again, the rim width characterization is a little subjective. So these are certain disadvantages. So we come to photographing and imaging. So when you take a photograph, like I showed, it's a very nice way of objectifying whatever you see. Now, photographs are two types. One is qualitative, is what the photograph is actually, is qualitative way of assessing. Quantitative is two types. You can have stereoscopic and with measurement, and then you have imaging. So this is a photography is actually a qualitative way of assessing it. So there are certain limitations. You have to have a clear media. You have to have a dilated pupil to get good photographs. Of course, nowadays you're getting a good non-midriatic fundus photography machines, and you have a skilled, you should require a skilled photographer. Cost implications are very important. That's why nowadays you have a handheld imaging devices coming into vogue. Okay, so now we come to the photographs. So what do you see here? Now we are going to correlate. This is a structure. So structure is defective. Can you see what defective structure it is? What do you have here? You have a wedge defect, isn't it? It's a broad wedge defect. So what sort of field is the patient going to have? So he's going to have a superior arcuate defect. Okay, so here we go again. Here, this is for the left eye. What is this? And what is this small area? Yeah, this is peripapillary atrophy. Okay, you have a wedge defect here. Okay, so what sort of field defect the patient is going to have? Superior arcuate. So here you go, absolutely correct. Okay, what do you see here? Is this normal, abnormal? You have a slit defect here. So what do you see for a slit defect like this? What do you think you're going to get? So when you send a patient, when you examine the patient like this and you're going to send him for a test, you should have some in your mind that you're going to get back either a positive test or a negative test. So you should always anticipate what you're going to get, because it's all a clinical diagnosis. So what do you think you're going to get? It's a slit defect. It's a slit defect in the arcuate region. So what is going to happen? Wedge defect, you have a full thing. In slit defect, what do you get? In the corner, you get a nasal depression. The patient has done the field first time, so these areas you have to disregard. What is this? Rim artifact, absolutely correct. So you have to correlate clinically. These two points are the most important ones. So when you do the next time, you have to educate the patient, does it properly, and then this is the only thing that should be left. If you, of course, it's a physiological test, so you may not always get it, but you must always remember that these points may always come and go, but these points should not expand. Okay? Because by glaucoma, by definition, the word progressive is added into it. So you label a person as glaucoma or glaucoma suspect, you must always repeat the same test again and again to assess progression. Okay? So this is some of the red-free photographs. And is there anything abnormal here? Can you make out anything abnormal? Yes, no, yes, no. Quick, quick. No, so nothing abnormal. Fine, I agree with you. So you get a good fields, okay? Now you get a good fields, but you're really not sure. What do you do next? So what is this? What have we done? We have seen the structure. And we've done a functional test. What is this known as? Structure function correlation. Okay, you see the structure, it should be functioning properly. That's it. Okay, so you do something called the imaging. So this is the very commonly used optic nerve head analysis way of checking. It's not mandatory in all patients. It's only for suspects and patients who have been confirmed, diagnosed with glaucoma to assess progressive, because small changes, the human eye is not able to pick up. Okay, so but when you look at a chart like this, you get totally zapped. So what do you do when you look at a chart like this? You go step by step. Okay, examiner has given you this chart. So look at you start reading it. You don't have to worry about what's written it. Once you start reading the chart loudly, because we have a DNB exam center, and when charts are given to the examiner, they get really, the students, they get really a bit fuddled, So you start reading. So there's a color photograph. The color photograph, you look at it, it shows you a green ring around the optic nerve head. So this shows that this area has been scanned. This is about 3.4 millimeter away from the optic nerve head. The next is thickness map. So this shows you hot areas and not so hot areas. Okay, so the hot area show that the thickness is good in this area. You can see that it's about 200 microns, 100 microns. Okay, so up you have a 200 micron area there, and these are hot areas. So this is a thickness map of the retinal nerve fiber layer. Then there's a significance map. Now if it is, the patient is significantly deviating from his age match normal, you will get red spots. If he's mildly deviating, you will get, you know, yellow spots. If, you know, so this is the significance map, the percentage of people who have this defect. If it's really in less than 1% of the population, you get a red pixel dots, okay? If it's less than that, you get yellow pixel spots. And then you also get a free, paid for red free photograph. So whatever you miss, we'll come to this again, because a lot of times we have missed it in the fundus photograph, we have picked it only in the OCT. So it's very important to see each area by itself. So, and then what the machine does is it will open up the scanned, this whole ring. It will open up the whole ring and display it like a one line. So you can find out the superior area, whether the retinal nerve fiber thickness is in the appropriate area or not. So inferiorly, it should be good enough. Superior also should be good. And then why do you have this dip here? So this dip is because of the nature of the superior nerve fiber layer bundles. This is a bifid. There are two poles. So usually you'll find the superior one will have a dip there. So you just have to look at it. That doesn't mean it's abnormal, but again you have to keep looking at it serially when you examine the patient, that this shouldn't come into the yellow or the red area. And it will give you sector wise. It will give clock hour wise, it will give sector wise. Yeah, all the analysis. You don't have to remember numbers, but you just have to know that every time the patient gets examined, whether these numbers drop or they increase. Okay? And then it will give you the most important information is something which you cannot measure, which is the disc area. So you have find that you are looking actually at a very large disc, 2.81 disc. So all this information is already given to you, you just have to read it loud in front of the examiner. So what about this disc? Is it normal, abnormal? So we'll go step by step. So what is the size? Is it normal size, large size? How do you know it's large size? Look at the macula, okay? The disc size is almost the size of the macula. So when you're given a photograph, always look the whole picture, you find out that it's a large disc. Both eyes, large disc. So you, what do you want to know? So I already told you, you're going to overestimate the cupping here. Because a large disc will have a large cup, a small disc will have a small cup, you're going to overestimate. So this is the visual fields. They're perfectly normal. What do you want to know next? You want to see the size of the disc. So for that, if you want, you can do a imaging. So what is the size of the disc? It's 3.16 in the right eye and 3.37 in the left eye. So it's a huge disc. So not all large discs are glaucoma, and not all small discs don't have glaucoma. Okay? What about this? Is it normal or abnormal? Okay, so this patient came to us and we examined him. Actually, he was examined elsewhere. Was he? Yeah, this is. So you find the visual fields and then you find there's a. Did you see this retinal nerve fiber layer defect here? Can you make that out? Is it very clear? Not very clear. So you use quantification here. So you find there's a retinal nerve fiber layer defect which is there in the significance map. That means that particular area is not supposed to be there in that particular age group of the patient. Because its defect is there, so it's labeled as a glaucoma. Okay, so you find that the retinal nerve fiber layer is really thinned out in that area. So this patient, can you make out something abnormal? Right eye, left eye? So these are small discs. Can you see that the size of the macula is huge and this disc is a little smaller? Anybody wants to hazard a guess? So we saw this patient, we said everything's fine. Then when we do the visual field, you find this. Now this is, I accept that this is a rim scotoma, but this spot was not very happy for me. Okay. Then when we were very perplexed, she was, you know, the next visit she had come again, we had dilated her, so we did a imaging. Imaging, we found that there's a, this is from the OCT image. So you find a red-free photograph, you find a RNFL defect here, which was missed on the first examination. Okay, so whenever you have a abnormal test, so with this test, we were thinking this is going to be a normal visual field test. Once you order a normal visual field test, this came as a abnormal here. We are not very happy with this two spots here. So we immediately did a scanning and we found that there's a retinal nerve fiber layer defect there. And of course, we correlated clinically and then we started treatment. That's a different story. But the thing is, structure and function have to correlate. And if a test throws something different, then you have to immediately go back and see what is different where. And you can find that the superior retinal RNFL is really thinned out in this particular position. Whereas the other structures in the right side, they are all pretty okay. So this patient came to us. He had a visual field done elsewhere. And then this was his defect. So many people thought it's a, you know, it's a neurological entity. So they sent him for a CT scan. What do you think this could be? CT scan was normal. Again, we repeat the visual field. It came out like this. Then we captured the fundus photograph. Is there anything abnormal in this? Anything abnormal? Why is there a field defect? What is it? Come, come, come. Everybody's pointing to it, but nobody wants to say. What is it? What do you see? So we did OCT as well, which is again normal. Okay? So what is wrong here? So this area of field defect is correlating with this area. What is this area? What is happening there? It's gliosis. It's retinal gliosis. It's quite extensive actually. If you see, if you look at the patient, it's almost all this whole area. So because of that, he's having a significant field defect which is mimicking a neurological entity. So whenever you have a doubt, what is the thing which I think Dr. Rashmin will you know, elaborate on that? What do you think you should do first when you want to differentiate between glaucoma and neuro? Loudly, loudly. Color vision, very good. So color vision is something which you should do immediately. Okay, it gives you a lot of idea that to differentiate glaucoma, because glaucoma vision is 6-6. Whether you do surgery, you don't do surgery, after surgery, before surgery, on treatment, without treatment, the patient is always having a 6-6 vision. Okay, so there are a lot of things to take home, but just in a nutshell, I'll just touch upon a few things. Hope it's been useful. Thank you for attending the All India Conference in Coimbatore. Thank you.